Welcome to the Advent Calendar House, the podcast that's getting a new deal for Christmas in July this year. Have you ever wondered how the stars of your favorite Broadway musicals celebrate Christmas when they're on a constant performing schedule and away from their families? Neither did I, but in 1977, somebody did, and they made a whole TV special about it. So join us as we smuggle ourselves out with the laundry back to 1977 and head to Broadway for the Annie Christmas Show. I am Scourge of at least four entertainment unions, Mike Westfall. And joining me, because I don't need sunshine now to turn my skies to blue, I don't need anything but Guy Hutchinson. Hello, Guy.
Hello. I am so excited once again to be on this. This is my favorite podcast of them all.
Thank you so much. Thank you for recommending this one. I had never heard of this special before you brought it to my attention.
Yeah, so this is an odd one. This was one that for years I was looking for, and then, you know, it popped up on YouTube several years back. And, you know, once that happens, it's out there. So I'm glad somebody took the time to record it, and even more so took the time to post it.
Yeah, and I don't think it occurred to me before starting to dig into this that in 1977, Annie as a musical was brand new.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it had come out, I think, that April. And so this was, and this was the same year that Star Wars came out, and the Star Wars holiday special would have been the next Christmas. So,
yeah, you're right. Yeah. But somehow I thought this was older. Like the character of Little Orphan Annie certainly is. She turns 100 this year, I think, as a comic character. But tell me a little bit about your history with discovering this.
Well, so I had read about it. I want to say it was in Leonard Maltin's guide, but I had read about it in some description of the movie Annie many years ago. And I was fascinated with the idea of it. They just described how it starts at the end of the play and then goes into this whole backstage thing. And everything about it sounded so unique, so different than anything else I had seen. And such a unique idea that they were promoting a current show. So they couldn't show you very much of that show. Right. So instead, they took that cast and wrote a whole new thing around it.
Yeah, I have the same comment that it's a very unique concept, and I feel like we haven't seen it since, but I kind of want to see some more of these. I'll get into that a little later, but I'm in what might be a small age window where I think of the movie adaptation of Annie first from 1982. We had it on tape, and I remember watching that a lot. And then my first real exposure to the stage version wasn't until I was about 12 or 13. I was part of a summer theater program. I was on the tech crew, and Annie was one of the first shows that summer that I worked on. And I remember painting the sets. We had to make the orphanage walls look really dingy.
I did get to see this show once on stage at the Pantages Theater in California, and Mackenzie Phillips was Mrs. Hannigan.
Oh, wow. But since I only knew the movie before that, I was confused as to why we were decorating the Warbucks Mansion for Christmas when I was doing that back in the summer, because the movie is set during the summer. It ends on the 4th of July. There's a whole fireworks ending.
Yeah. So the movie has a very different ending. The actual Broadway show, the last song at the end of the show is this song about Christmas and the New Deal.
Yeah. Which makes this special we watched a lot easier to understand why they already have a tree there on the set. It's part of the show. So you mentioned Annie the Musical debuted on Broadway in April of 1977, was an instant hit, won 7 Tony Awards that summer. This special aired December 4th, 1977. It was a Sunday night on NBC. I'm not sure whether NBC approached the show's producers or the other way around with this idea of creating this Christmas special, but you don't see a lot of Broadway shows on network TV unless they do one of those live performances that are produced specifically to air on TV on a soundstage.
But those are usually done towards the end of the run of a show. This show was brand new. So this was, if they had performed too much of it, they do give us a little taste of the show, but if they gave away too much, I mean, they wanted people to, you know, to go out to New York City, go to Broadway and see this show in person.
Yeah, so they gave us just a little taste. It'll be right in the middle. We'll get to it when we get there. But this was recorded on the show's home stage on Broadway on what was then the Alvin Theater. It's now called the Neil Simon Theater.
What's interesting about this is the actors are sort of playing themselves, but not really, because none of these kids have families. Everybody in the cast only has each other.
Yeah, that's a very weird line that they need to cross a few times during this whole thing. Let's get into it. If you want to watch this, it was never officially released, to my knowledge. I found a recording on YouTube, and there's one on the Internet Archive. I'll put that link in the show notes. But like you said, this special begins as the show itself ends. The cast is taking their final bows, and we can hear the actors talking to each other through their gritted smiles.
You have any luck at Sardi's?
No, nothing doing.
Yeah, they're mentioning the restaurants that they've checked. They checked Sardi's, which a very famous restaurant. The Rainbow Room is mentioned at one point. And then I love the line, "There's no room at the Holiday Inn," which I thought was a great little gag. And then they also mentioned a ballroom, a big ballroom that was in New York City that's gone now. But it used to be like a roller rink and everything. And they used to do all kinds of shows there. I'm blanking on the name of it, but it was a very famous venue, the Roseland Ballroom.
Oh, okay.
They say that even the Roseland was busy. And I actually got to go there. That place is closed down now. But many years ago, I was going to a premiere of the movie Princess and the Frog, the Disney movie. And they said afterwards they had a princess event that was going to be down the street. And I was like, all right, I'm not going to the princess event. And then I heard it was at the Roseland Ballroom. And I said, well, I don't know that I'll ever get another chance. And sure enough, I never did. So I went over there and checked it out. And, you know, it was pretty neat. It was very run down. When I went there, I could see why it didn't last much longer. But it was a historic venue that was right there on the other side of Broadway.
Wow. Okay. And that's a fun little event to kind of end it on.
Yeah.
Princess and the Frog. Yeah. Everybody's trying to talk to each other through the gritted teeth, except Daddy Warbucks. He gives up on not moving his lips right away. He is played by Reed Shelton. And let's get this out of the way now. Everybody in the original Broadway cast of Annie is best known for being in the original Broadway cast of Annie, even now.
Yes.
That's how popular it was.
That is true. Although I will tell you, Reed had a performance that I very much remember from an episode of Cheers. It's probably my favorite episode of Cheers. It's the one where Harry the Hat, played by Harry Anderson, who always comes in there and kind of, you know, plays them for suckers and gets their money. He finds out that this guy named George, who's played by Reed, is ripping off Coach for, you know, thousands of dollars. And he's like, well, nobody fleeces my sheep but me. And so he sets up this whole elaborate con where Coach is going to, you know, win the money back from George. I don't know if you've ever seen the episode, but anybody that has will remember the whole "I scratched my nose because it's itchy. It was really itchy" line. Very, very funny. The whole ending with the guy yelling at Coach and then Coach laughing and then the big reveal with Harry Anderson. It's probably my favorite episode of Cheers. And that's the only thing I knew him from. And when I saw him in this, I didn't recognize him until after I read that was in his credits. But as soon as I heard that, I looked at his face and just pictured him with hair, and that was it.
Okay. Yeah, I'm not recalling that episode of Cheers. I looked through his IMDb, and I saw that episode. Wikipedia said his most famous TV role was on The Golden Girls. He ran the museum where Blanche worked, but that was one episode.
Yeah, I don't remember. And I've seen all the Golden Girls, so I'm sure I saw that, but I don't remember that episode. But the Cheers episode, it's first season one. It's a great Coach episode. It's a Harry Anderson episode. So if you're a fan of his, it might be my favorite episode. I can't even think of what would compete with it to be the best episode of that show. Maybe the Thanksgiving one. The Thanksgiving one's a little better, but other than that.
And Annie herself is played by Andrea McCardle.
There's no room at the Holiday Inn.
I've talked about her on this podcast way back more than 5 years ago now, a year after Annie's debut, Andrea McArdle appeared on the special Christmas at Walt Disney World.
Ah, very cool.
That's a crazy special. That ended up being one of the longest episodes of this podcast, just because of how much was going on in that. She shows up at the end.
This is a very straightforward special. They tell you the plot. They go through it. It is an easy watch because it's just a lot of musical numbers. If you cut out the musical numbers, I mean, it's probably 5 minutes long. they never stray from the premise, and they give you exactly what they promise.
Oh, yeah. It's an easy sell for me. And yeah, you're right. There's not a lot of content besides the songs, but the songs are what we're here to see. Let's be honest.
Right.
So who else we got? Playing Miss Hannigan is Dorothy Loudon, who won the Tony that year for Best Actress in a Musical.
Buck up, little troopers. Just think how lucky you are to be working in a Broadway musical.
Before this on TV, Dorothy Loudon was featured on the Perry Como and Ed Sullivan shows and was briefly a regular cast member on the Gary Moore Show in 1962, replacing another future Miss Hannigan, Carol Burnett.
Ah, wow. The movie version.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of these actors, you know, best known for Annie, which if you're going to be best known for a Broadway show, that's a pretty great one.
Oh, yeah.
And these were people that had also performed in a lot more stage work than they did television work. But it's interesting to see how most of them still ended up on a handful of TV shows here and there.
Yeah, it's a lot of one-off episodes. This next one, we'll move on. Sandy Faison plays Daddy Warbucks' Secretary Grace.
How'd it go at the Rainbow Grill?
Terrible. No hope there.
This is her Broadway debut. On screen, I might have seen her in an episode of The Wonder Years. She played the mother of one of Kevin's one-off girlfriends, but...
Oh, okay.
That was something that stuck out to me. I know I've seen every episode of The Wonder Years, so I'm sure I've seen her. She was also in a 1997 movie called Get a Clue, based on the book The Westing Game, if anyone remembers reading that book in middle school.
Hmm.
So those four are trying to discreetly talk to each other while taking their bows about their attempts to find a place to host their Christmas party for the cast and crew.
Right. For some reason, this wasn't thought about, you know, before this night, it appears. It appears that like everybody just started like trying to make a reservation. They're only looking at, other than the Holiday Inn, they're only looking at really famous places. They either want to be at the Holiday Inn or a very famous restaurant or ballroom. And none of them have a family to go home to. So it's good. They're all vagabonds that only exist within the universe of this play.
Now, they can't go home. They got to work on Christmas, because sometimes you have to work on Christmas.
Yep.
But Reed Shelton has to break it to all the other kids in the cast that it looks like their party's off. And all of these girls playing the other orphans are still reacting in character.
We tried everywhere.
Restaurants, hotels, even Roseland.
They've been booked for weeks. There's just no place for us to have a Christmas party.
Oh, gee. No party. What a kick in the teeth.
Right. And it's interesting that he's the one that has to tell them, because again, they're playing their characters. Like normally, you know, just because he's Daddy Warbucks, he wouldn't be the one that would have to break this to them. But because we're watching a special, that's how that would work.
Sure. He needs to be the voice here. He's taking action. But yeah, all of these girls are still very much in character mode. The little girl playing Molly in particular reacts, "Oh, gee, no party."
Yes. Now, so Molly, you have her name is Danielle, and then I never know how to pronounce her last name.
I looked it up because I could have gone either way, but it's Danielle Brisbois.
Ah, okay. It's fancy.
Yes.
I did know her name, though, because it would always be in the closing credits of All in the Family once she started appearing on that. And then also Archie Bunker's place.
Yeah, she plays Archie Bunker's niece, Stephanie.
Yeah. So, well, I think technically Stephanie turned out wasn't their niece, but she was related to them. There's a whole convoluted backstory with Stephanie. It's one of the more tragic off-screen characters, is her mother and family. But she showed up basically, I think, because Gloria had moved out and they needed somebody younger to be on there on the show, because that show was on for so long. And so I always enjoyed, because I watched that as a kid, which, by the way, is not, it is not appropriate for children.
But it was on. It was like, I forget what it was on after when they would, even when they would rerun it, they would, yeah, it would just always be on. It's just like, well, I guess I'm still watching TV. I don't want to turn it off yet.
No, we would watch All in the Family. We'd watch The Jeffersons. We'd watch Good Times, but also like Three's Company. All of these shows are wildly inappropriate for small children.
Oh, yeah.
I guess we didn't get a lot of it, but I did like that because there was now a kid on that show and watching, you know, Carol O'Connor play this befuddled Archie Bunker trying to deal with a child, the least child friendly character. And yet, of course, he was always, you know, his heart was always warmed by her. And so it was very good to see her in this.
Yeah. Well, and it turns out I knew Danielle Brisbois from somewhere else.
Ooh.
Have you ever heard of the band New Radicals?
I have not heard of this. I have heard that she was some kind of a rock star or something. Please tell me the story about this.
She co-founded this band, New Radicals. They were like a two-hit wonder in the late 90s. They had that song, You Get What You Give. And another one I know is Someday We'll Know. But I know this band, and she was one of the two co-founders.
Wow.
They only lasted a few years. But yeah, one of them was Molly.
That's crazy.
So here she is with the other girls, including Andrea McCarroll, now sitting around bummed that they can't have their Christmas party. They were really looking forward to it when in walks the theater's owner, as I make air quotes, Mr. Nicolander, congratulating them on a wonderful show.
Wonderful!
Evening, Mr. Nicolander.
You have them on their feet, cheering, clapping their hands off. And there is nothing like applause to warm the heart of a tough old theater owner. Especially when the applause comes from a house full of paying customers.
Now, his name is a play on Niederlander, which was the group that owned the theater in real life. And there was a Mr. Niederlander. I think he had passed away by this point. But the Niederlander Theater Group, I think to this day, is like the one of the largest Broadway theater owners. And so the gag was, here's the guy who owns the actual theater, and he's coming, you know, to talk to them.
Okay.
They never say it. They never say it. But it to me, that I and I might be wrong about this, but that to me sounded like where the name would come from.
Oh, that's a great guess, though. But this obviously is not the real owner of the theater.
No. Yeah, this is an actor.
No, it's one of the actors in the show. It's Raymond Thorne, who played FDR in the cast.
Oh, wow. So, okay. I was looking for him. So I saw his only picture that I saw on IMDb is him in the wheelchair as FDR. And so I was trying to figure out who he was in this production. That makes so much more sense. Now, that's not his name, though, right? The actor playing him, it has a different last name, or is that the actor's last name?
The actor's name is Raymond Thorne.
So Raymond Thorne is playing two parts within this play. Am I understanding this correctly?
He sure is. Well, you barely see FDR in this. He's conveniently not taking a bow with the other cast, and now we know why.
But so all of the other actors are playing them their real name as a character, you know.
Yeah.
Like Daddy Warbucks is playing himself playing Daddy Warbucks, and this guy is playing a different character playing another character.
Oh, yeah. This has layers.
I never noticed that in the past. I just had always, and when I rewatched it today, I kind of, you know, it was a rewatch where I was just looking for different things. And so I didn't pick that up. That's interesting.
I had to look. Well, I'm looking at like the cast list. I'm just like, this has got to be somebody. Who is this? And then I'm matched up the picture of Raymond Thorne that I could find with this guy. I'm like, oh, this is definitely the same person.
Interesting.
But he's Mr. Nicolander here, asks why everyone's so gloomy, and they explain the situation, that they can't find anywhere to have their Christmas party, and one of the other girls sits up and says, if only there was somewhere with a big room like this. And one of the others chimes in with a big Christmas tree like that, pointing to the set piece, and it keeps going on until Andrea, finally, a light bulb goes off.
I've got it. Why don't we have our party right here?
Yeah!
Yep.
Even Sandy the dog stands up here, and everyone else does.
Yeah, Sandy the dog, when I saw the show, what I was surprised about initially was how little Sandy is in the actual musical, but it makes sense. It is very hard to control a dog. So Sandy would show up a few times in the key scenes, like the dumb dog song and stuff.
Yeah.
And Sandy would come on stage, crowd would go nuts. And the dog would kind of stare at the crowd like, what's going on here? And then I felt there was a little bit of that with this. Also, dogs have a habit, which this dog did several times, of yawning during scenes that are not supposed to be boring, which you can't tell a dog not to.
No, can't do that. But otherwise, an extremely well-behaved dog during all of the girls suddenly standing up and cheering. But Mr. Nicolander is very quick to pipe up. Now, hold it. You can't have your Christmas party here. He says, I'm a businessman, not Santa Claus. So then Danielle Brisbois taps him on the arm and quietly asks,
please, Mr. Nicolander.
And every single girl follows one by one, please, Mr. Nicolander, ending with Dorothy Loudon, Miss Hannigan, who sweetly adds, for the kids and for Sandy, who right on cue whines a little sad whine. And he hopelessly looks around at all the sad, pleading faces and then turns to Andrea, who just smiles her sweet little innocent Annie smile. And that's what breaks him. He rolls his eyes and says, all right, you can have your party here on one condition. And he tells them they have to get all the other unions to agree to keep the theater open after hours without pay.
Right. This is a tall order.
It is. So now the cast has to appeal to four union groups: wardrobe, musicians, electricians, and stagehands. Feels like a video game quest.
Now, before we get to each one, I just have a general question about these different union people that they speak to. Do you know anything about any of these actors? Were these performers from the show, or are these performers that were hired just for this special, does it appear?
It doesn't say.
Yeah, I could not figure it out. And like the closing credits listed some people who they played, but most people it didn't. And so for a lot of this, it was guesswork.
Yeah, I'm sure that most of them are just ensemble performers for Annie.
Sure. Yeah, no, that, I mean, it would make sense if they all were. I just would love to know.
No, a lot of them don't have a lot of credits, certainly not on IMDb, because they're stage people. So,
yep.
But yeah, Mr. Nicolander informs them they've never said yes to him before, but there's a first time for everything. But Andrea thinks positive. She says, we'll get their permission and you can come too. But Mr. Nicolander reveals he won't be in town for Christmas. He's got a trip booked to the Bahamas. And then he's like, well, later. Walks off stage and Reed Shelton rallies everyone and takes the adult cast members aside to plan on who's going to appeal to which union while the kids stay and celebrate. And they're like, oh boy, we're going to have a Christmas party. And the opening credits roll.
Yeah, very interesting, because when they first start, we're seeing closing credits, which I assume are supposed to be the closing credits for the Broadway show, which I thought was kind of a neat way to start. And then we get credits here, and we get a beautiful title sequence here with like those where it looks like maybe paper that we're looking at that's being photographed and shown on screen, like a painting of Annie, very low tech kind of intro.
Yeah, I had assumed the credits at the beginning of the recording we watched might have been the closing credits for some other thing that aired before that, because this looks like some kind of like theater themed block of programming they had. Okay. Even the commercials, which I'm going to talk about later, the commercials are all like Broadway themed.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them anyway, but
we did get a sponsor for this program, which was Kinney Shoes,
which
I thought was interesting. That was a name I have not heard in a long time.
No, me neither. I definitely remember it, though. But that's one of the ones, like all of the Kinney Shoes commercials during this show were all like song and dance numbers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
But we're off to our first union, the wardrobe department, which is not at all just different set pieces moved onto this closed curtain stage. It's a bunch of ladies sitting around a table sewing costumes when Andrea walks in, sits right on top of the table with the dog onto their clothes that they're trying to hem, tells them they're all looking gorgeous today.
This is, by the way, where Sandy just yawns like repeatedly.
It was hard to climb up on that table. Then the rest of the kids walk in along with Sandy Faison, Grace, who just explains.
Oh, we just thought we'd drop by and say hi and Merry Christmas, kids.
Hi and Merry Christmas.
And ring some jingle bells at them. They almost sound like the chipmunks here, the way they enunciate Merry Christmas. And one of the wardrobe staff responds, Christmas, are they having that again this year? Which is a great line. But the jig's already up before they even got there. The whole department knows they want to throw a Christmas party, and their answer is a resounding no, accompanied by that theatrical little head nod when you're done saying resounding anything.
Mm-hmm.
So Sandy, the actress, not the dog.
Yes, that is confusing.
Yeah. Asks them, where's your Christmas spirit? Think of Yule logs and eggnog. And Andrea adds chestnuts roasting on an open fire. And the others chime in with their own festive stuff as they launch into the special's main theme song, It's Christmas.
Chestnuts roasting on an open fire.
Jack Frost snipping at your nose.
Mistletoe.
Tinsel. Candy cane.
Bong, 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 bong. Cathedral chimes ring in your ear.
Your heart is filled with warmth and cheer.
And all over town, what's the one thing you hear?
It's Christmas. Yeah!
And I've got to say, it's a catchy song. I like it.
Yeah, no, I took note of each song and you know, said, let me make a decision whether I like them or not. And this song I definitely like. I thought it's really good. It's very Christmassy. The special, which sometimes is not the case with these specials, it has stayed Christmassy so far through every scene.
So far. They've already played the music of the song over the opening credits and leading into the scene, and it's going to continue. So if you're watching this, get used to hearing it. But as far as the song itself, with the music, I'd like to hear it more. So I added it to my playlist, but it's not the version you hear in this special, the one I found streaming on Apple Music. They didn't release the music from this special anywhere, but in 2008, there was a 30th anniversary album of Annie released. It was a year late, but whatever. They put together this all-star team of former cast members for this, and It's Christmas was re-recorded as a bonus track featuring not only a grown-up Andrea McCardle, but several other Annies.
Oh, wow.
And then they added several Miss Hannigans to this version of the song and got several actresses who have portrayed her, including Carol Burnett, Sally Struthers, and Kathy Lee Gifford are all on this track. It's interesting.
Wow.
It's Christmas.
I hate Christmas.
Grandmas arrive and they produce.
I hate Christmas.
I'm going to put that link in the show notes. It's not hard to find this album, but very interesting to listen to. And it's a little slower than this one. It's not quite as upbeat, but I was just like, yeah, I'll put this on my playlist. It's fun. But I do like this original version from the special. It's peppier and you've got Sandy Faison hitting some extra high notes with the kids to the point where one of the wardrobe ladies falls out of her chair. Every single person in this is hamming it up, but I mean, that's the kind of show Annie is, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
But these women are not having it. They get their own verse to complain about the less fun things about Christmas and winter, like
Jack Frost giving you frostbite,
Yule log smoke up the house, ruin the drapes,
eggnog spilled on your shag rug.
Eggnog spilled on your shag rug, one complains, because it's the 70s.
That's, I was going to say, 1977.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I thought that was great. I love that they were calling back to the same, all the positives were turned into negatives. I thought this was real fun.
This is such a fun song, but despite one final plea from the girls, it ends with yes,
no!
And all the girls collapse on each other in loud, oh, boo-hoo-hoo!
Another thing of note in the song, they mentioned that your Christmas cards getting returned because you forgot to put the zip on them. And it's interesting. The zip code was only, I think, 14 years old at this point. So while we're super used to zip codes, I think that was something people probably, I mean, it's like how you tend to write the last year on a check in the old days. I think not adding a zip code probably happened to people for a long time.
Yeah, it was still kind of new then. You're right. I didn't even think of that at all. So that's one failed attempt. Let's see if Dorothy Loudon has better luck. She's volunteered to appeal to the Musicians Union, and I believe she said she's a member herself, but can she convince the others? Again, it's really just another set on a black box stage, and instead of hangers full of clothes, they've hung a bunch of musical instruments on the walls and brought in a grand piano, because everyone knows the Musicians Union spends all of their off time hanging out and playing together.
Yeah, it's crazy. The set here is just nuts. I mean, there are instruments everywhere. It just looks absurd.
Yeah. Hang out, play together. Piano player seems to be in charge. Dorothy calls him Maestro, and he's still dressed in a tux and bow tie.
Mm-hmm.
Asks for a moment of their time, but the maestro tells her, "Hold on, Dorothy. You know the rules of the musician's department."
I forgot.
Imagine being in a work meeting and everyone has to sing.
Well, I think if you're on Broadway, that probably does happen.
just like every Tuesday, there's just like, all right, we're singing today.
I mean, if you know show people, you know they break into song for no reason all the time.
Oh,
I mean,
yeah, all the time.
I'm right here.
That's the only industry where you can really get away with that. Like,
yes.
I've heard the people I work with sing Happy Birthday, and we're all terrible. Luckily, this is reigning Tony-winning Best Lead Actress in a Musical, Dorothy Loudon, we're talking about here. So she humbly launches into...
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas everywhere you go.
I know, but I don't care.
I don't care, which people who like musicals will recognize from the Judy Garland movie In the Good Old Summertime.
Okay.
Yeah, but the song's actually a lot older. It was written in 1905, but I recognized it from somewhere completely different. In Back to the Future, The Game.
Oh, wow.
Marty McFly goes back to 1931, and we hear this song at a speakeasy performed by a singer we later find out is his own grandmother.
I don't care.
Yeah. So I played this game.
Yeah.
This game, and there are some great videos that you can find online of it. So, and it's a wonderful game. If you have,
it was such a fun game.
If you've got a Wii in your closet, that's not what I mean. If you have a Nintendo Wii in your closet, you should pull it out and go on eBay, see if you can get this game, because it is such a perfect sequel to the Back to the Future movies.
Absolutely. This is the closest thing we're going to get to a Back to the Future sequel, but it's really well written. Bob Gale was involved with it, so like it's very well done. And this is sung by Trixie Trotter is her stage name, but we turned out, nope, it's the future Sylvia McFly. Sings this song, I Don't Care, which I guess is public domain at this point if it was written in 1905, so they were able to put it in that game. But the maestro here doesn't care because he adds, he'll be home for Christmas. And he and Dorothy start arguing back and forth in different songs until she tells him to move over, and now they're fighting via piano.
You gotta do what you done before, baby.
Yeah, I like this. I thought this whole piece was very good. I thought they were both very good going back and forth. I thought it was very clever.
Yeah, it's really well done. And it culminates in Dorothy singing and tap dancing to strike up the band.
If cymbals ring, calling one and all, do the marshal swing, strike up the band.
Yeah, she goes, I mean, right to center stage. She's moving. And it's so funny because up until that point, I was thinking, I guess she's not going to dance. This is probably, you know, we've probably seen where this song is going. And then, I mean, it just takes off. The song, it ends bigger than it starts. I thought it was a really great, really, you know, Broadway style song. And it's funny, throughout most of this song, I was like, all right, I'm going to put that. I didn't love this one. And then it ends and I was like, all right, I love that one too, so I'm gonna check off that I love that.
Yeah, no, even the other musicians are accompanying her as backup dancers here.
Yes, it's so good.
Only in a musical will you get in an argument with five other people and it ends with them all dancing with you.
Yes.
And for a brief moment I thought, is she gonna get through to them? But their final answer is also an enthusiastic no.
Yep.
Even one of the musicians unbuttons his shirt to reveal a t-shirt underneath that says no.
Yeah.
They were waiting for her.
I love that. This guy had, he's just standing there in the background and all of a sudden he unzips and has this shirt that says no. I was like, where did that come from? How did he, I mean, was this just happenstance that he happened to wear his no shirt on that day? I love that.
They're used to having to tell people no.
They weren't far from the wardrobe people. I guess they could have asked for one.
Sure. It's the same room. It's become clear at this point that every department has already heard of the plan to ask them all permission to have a party after hours at the theater without pay. And this group in particular has decided to prepare their answer to clearly show them that this guy had put it on a shirt. They made a shirt that said no on it because they knew this was going to happen.
Mm-hmm. Don't go away.
The Annie Christmas Show was brought to you by the world's largest retailer of film developing services, the more than 3,000 Photomat stores, where all they do is everything you need for taking good pictures. And by Kinney Shoes, fitting America's lifestyle coast to coast. Kinney, the great American shoe store.
Fellow Americans, stop dragging your feet. Wear Kinney's when you're going to go out on a date.
Look great.
But do you know your feet need a little love?
Kinney knows.
What an agonizing, enterprising, hard kind of day you spend working overtime. You.
Yeah, it's ball.
You. When you, you need shoes for it all. Say comfort and style if you're young at heart or young enough to remember. Come to Kinney and explore.
Hi, I'm Bob.
And I'm Mark.
And we are the Festive Foreign Film Fans.
Try saying that three times fast.
I know. We read your minds. Among all those angry hosts and shows with people doing bad things to each other.
Plus the many Tis the Cozy Total Christmas in the 80s podcast you were thinking. You know, the world needs another Christmas podcast.
And why not? All those murderers, they get so many popular shows. But what about Christmas? It never killed anyone. So join us on the 6th and the 25th of each month as we explore our shared humanity and the movies and music of different countries through a common holiday that we all share.
And we may offer some relationship advice or even solve a crime or two.
Wow!
Festive Foreign Film Fans, coming in June to a podcast channel near you.
When can I pick up the pictures?
Thursday. This
Thursday. Okay, let me make a note of that.
You're going to write it down there?
I was going to,
oh,
yeah.
Well, then let's say Tuesday.
You mean 2 days earlier?
No, five days later.
Uh-huh. I thought as much.
If this customer were at a Photomat store, we'd be introducing him to our brand new picture pickup promise. Photomat's way of telling you exactly when your pictures will be ready.
That quick?
Sure, and if it doesn't work out, you get a free roll of film.
Oh, no. You get in trouble for that.
Oh, it's no problem.
Huh?
It's a Photomat policy.
The Photomat picture pickup promise.
Is there a Photomat store around here?
Well, it's time for a commercial break, and there's another commercial here for Photomat, just to really date this.
Yeah, man. Speaking of Back to the Future, although it was Fox Photo and Back to the Future, but yeah, the kiosk, we used to drive up, we'd drop off our film, and then some guy would stand in that little booth, and then I guess hand it off to someplace else where they put it to a dark room, and they got it back there, and you'd go pick it up. The old joke about the people that worked in the Photomat was, what do they do when they have to take a break? Do they just lie on the floor so you can't see them?
Didn't even think about that. Yeah, these tiny kiosks used to be outside almost every strip mall in the country. Mm-hmm. And then they were obsolete by the 90s.
Yep.
But I'm so glad this copy preserved the commercials. This in 1977 has to be one of the earliest copies of something I've watched for the podcast that was taped off the TV.
Now, you watched it from where, archive or YouTube?
I watched it on YouTube, but I think the archive version is just the same copy.
Okay, because there were some cuts in the commercials. It was as if somebody had you know, been like, oh, these are commercials. No one will want to watch these in 2024.
Right. But they kept some, and I'm glad they did. But we return after those messages to find Reed Shelton entering the dark lair of the Electricians Union. He's got a lit match just so he can see, because when the electricians aren't working, the lights are out.
Right. Yeah. I mean, they don't want to use any electricity.
No, they tell him they love electric light so much they can't stand to see it wasted. And unfortunately, one of these two guys is wearing a very large, elaborate Native American chief's headdress because he's the chief electrician.
Yeah, that's a gag you would not say today.
No, boo. He does a war cry later just to be extra racist. It's very silly.
Yeah, this scene is kind of the weirdest one of the whole bunch. Like the electricians, I kept trying to figure out who they were, because the one guy, it obviously wouldn't have been time-wise, but the one guy looked a lot like Matt Frewer, and they really like these two seemed.
He does.
And these two guys seemed like they might be like some kind of comedy duo that existed at that time that I'm just not familiar with. But they were really funny. And it kind of got, you kind of got the feeling that this was, I don't know, like I felt like these two worked together before, but I couldn't figure out who they were.
Yeah, neither did I. But no, they were definitely a highlight of this.
Don't touch that light.
But electricians, don't you like electric light?
We don't like electric light, friend. We love electric light. That's why we can't stand to see it wasted.
Oh. Could you move your head, please? It's shining in my eyes.
Oh, sorry.
Yes. Yeah, the light is reflecting off Reed's head.
Yeah. Which is not a bald cap, by the way. Reed Shelton shaved his head to play Daddy Warbucks.
Oh, yeah. Well, you got to do that.
Sure.
I will say, on the episode of Cheers, he had very little hair. So, I mean, this was not a great loss.
Yeah. The other guy just has his hair standing on end like he's been holding one of those Tesla globes you see in science labs.
Correct. Yeah. And they do this effect throughout this, which is like, I don't know if it's chroma key or whatever it is, but it's wild because there are no other effects like this throughout this entire production. So this special only uses this type of effect here.
Yeah, it's the only place where it is. It's this colorful neon outline of their profiles to suggest that they're very electrically charged.
Yes. But it's funny because it doesn't seem to follow the rules of the universe they've set up for us.
Nope.
It's like this gag, it was so good that they were like, well, we got to put this gag in here, even though it will make the rest of this seem even more far-fetched.
Yeah. No, it doesn't need to make sense. It just needs to look good. It's a nice little effect from 1977.
Mm-hmm.
But the other guy with the static hair explains this is the worst time of year for them because of how much electricity Christmas lights use.
Yeah.
He wonders why people can't use old-fashioned methods of illumination like this. And the book he's reading catches fire because it's one of those magician's books that you open and a big old flame erupts from it.
Yeah. So we get this whole little magic act all of a sudden.
Right. He's a magician now. That's called a hot book, by the way. And you can just go buy one on the internet.
Oh, very cool. He even he puts the flames towards his mouth and everything. He really goofs around with the flames.
Yeah. And he's got this long match. He holds it in his hand. He pretends to eat it as the flame goes out.
Yeah.
And then they stick a light bulb in Reed's ears and they both turn on and he grins a goofy grin like Uncle Fester.
Yes.
One of the electricians tells him, "You must be a star." And they answer his question, "Where would Broadway be without light?" "Nowhere, that's where. And I smell another song cue."
Mm-hmm.
Ree begins singing, "There's a broken heart for every light on Broadway."
Oh, let me live on Broadway, where the lights are all aglow, where everyone seems happy in the crowds that come and go.
Yeah, so this is a song that obviously has nothing to do with Christmas. It would have been a song that the audience watching would have been familiar with. So it's kind of it's kind of good from that perspective. Not one of my favorites of the show.
No, yeah, this is not a song from Annie. This song dates back to 1916 with music by Fred Fisher and lyrics by Howard E. Johnson. Wasn't written for any specific show, but it made its way into a 2014 musical called Bullets on Broadway, based on a Woody Allen movie.
Oh, yeah. Huh.
The song was sung on that musical by Maren Mazzie and Zach Braff.
Wow. It's interesting. Today we get a lot of, you know, Mrs. Doubtfire on Broadway, you know, Legally Blonde on Broadway. And it's interesting that Annie, you know, 1977, this was based on a comic strip. So, you know, the idea of, you know, basing your Broadway show off of some existing IP is nothing new.
No, no, not at all. That was around the same time. I think You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown, is from the same time.
Yeah. I think, I mean, you know, right around that time. And I mean, even if you go back, there was a Little Abner musical many decades before this. So, I mean, you know, the idea of, you know, taking something that existed elsewhere and making it into a Broadway show has kind of always been part. You got to sell those tickets. You know?
Yeah. Yep. Anyway, Reed pleads to the electricians, don't put us in the dark on Christmas Eve. And he pulls out a wallet with a long fold-out display of the photos of each of the girls playing Annie and the other orphans in the cast.
It's such a great gag.
So you see, kids, wallets used to come with little mini photo albums that you could put tiny pictures of your loved ones in while you look for your credit card or take out a dollar bill.
Let me tell you something, Mike. My dad recently took his wallet out to pay for something and he left it in the car. And my mom picked it up and flipped through it. And she sent me pictures. He still has a picture in his wallet in the plastic little photo thing of me when I was like 8. So it's like my school picture.
He
put it in there. And my dad has just used the same wallet since then. And the picture hasn't changed.
Sure. Yeah. They still offer wallet sized photos for school picture day, but we don't even order print photos. We just get them digitally now.
Yeah, that's what it was, man. You would give that photo to, and I keep pictures in my wallet too, but I don't have that clear plastic thing, but that thing was the best.
Yeah, it was great. And here it's the old, look, I got a wife and kids trope.
Yep.
Don't put us in the dark on Christmas Eve. For if you do, there'll be 10 more broken hearts on Broadway. The hearts of these 9 little girls in Annie and their dog, Sam.
And Reed gives the song a big finish, which illuminates the whole room with those neon outlines again.
Mm-hmm.
Gee, Reed, if your voice can cause a power surge, why don't you just light up the party yourself? The electricians give him a round of applause, sits down and asks, so what about the party? And the one electrician takes out his magic flame again to light Reed's cigar and tells him, you can have your party.
But when you step out on the floor, you'll be dancing in the dark.
And the two electricians tango off the stage, laughing as the lights go out.
Yeah, this was a great scene. It was very silly, very weird. I liked it.
Yeah. Well, that's 3 down now. So their last hope lies with the stagehands, and we're back to Andrea, who's trying to convince Sandy Faison that desperate times call for desperate measures, and it's time for them to resort to Plan X. What's Plan X? We'll find out in a minute, but first, Sandy pleads with her to try Plan W first. W in this case is for womp womp. What a silly joke. But in goes Andrea to talk to the stagehands, who are playing cards around a poker table. They're all wearing the loudest Hawaiian shirts.
Yes. Yes. Almost matching. At first, I thought they were matching shirts, but they're not. They all have different shirts, but they're so similar. They're so Hawaiian. I love this. I love that they're all playing cards. I love how incredibly difficult it is to distract them. Yeah. Everything about this, it's so like it is exactly what they're trying to do, is trying to paint the picture of what people thought union guys would be doing backstage. And that's it. They're all sitting around playing cards in their Hawaiian shirts.
And their Hawaiian shirts, all unbuttoned down the middle. I thought they were bare-chested underneath, but no, they're all wearing orange, almost skin-tone undershirts.
Yeah, they got their tank tops on. Yeah. And they're, you know, it's great.
Completely ignoring Andrea and Sandy singing. They try singing Silver Bells, but the stagehands don't even acknowledge them. So Andrea says, it's time to play dirty, and Plan X is Little Molly, little Danielle Brisbois, sadly singing Deck the Halls while dressed up as the little match girl.
Deck the hall with bells of holly, la 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 la.
And she's super adorable. The character of Molly always is.
Oh, yeah.
And so it's so perfect. It's like if anything can win these guys over.
just singing while Andrea and Sandy are up on ladders throwing fake snow on her.
Yes. And Molly is trying so hard to keep her eyes open. It's like these snowflakes are hitting her right in the eye. I mean, it's great.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, your face. And the stagehands finally start to take notice. One stands up and says,
"That's the most beautiful thing I ever heard. It's beautiful."
And he starts to weep, and the others follow suit. They say it's the first time they felt the true spirit of Christmas welling up inside of them, and they start to feel compelled to do things like go home to their family or buy presents for all the loved ones they have so long neglected. That's a direct quote.
Yes.
One says, "I got to go out and give money away in the streets."
I love it. And I love that it's so ridiculous.
Yeah. And you can tell it's ridiculous. And finally, one of them turns around and asks, "What about that Christmas party you want to have?" "Our answer is," and the girls reply, "Yes." And all the stagehands shout,
"No!"
Got him.
Yep. It's so great.
And so Andrea and Sandy dump all the remaining snow on them.
Yeah, it's so perfect. I mean, you're expecting that to be the conclusion. And then you're like, maybe it's not going to happen. Maybe they're going to say yes. And then they give the no.
No, they're now 0-4. None of the unions have agreed to have this Christmas party. And it's now Christmas Eve, and the cast is backstage before that night's performance. And Reed calls the company together to remind them that there's an audience out there in a festive holiday mood, so let's not let them down.
Yeah, even though we can't do our Christmas party, we've been stymied across the board, we still got to go out and do our show and make everybody happy.
That's right. And then someone tells them it's 5 minutes to curtain, and I call shenanigans. Yes, I'm aware this whole thing is scripted, and it's been lovely so far, but in this scene, all the actors are in plain clothes.
Yeah.
No one's dressed for their parts. There is no way that would be the case with 5 minutes before showtime.
This is way too casual for a Broadway show. Yeah. I mean, this community theater doesn't work this way. You certainly would never get away with this on that caliber of a show.
Not even my kids' school plays would that be the case. 5 minutes to curtain.
Yeah, no, you've got to be there well in advance. You got to be in your costume. Goodness.
Yeah. My kids were just in Cats, so they had to be there 2 hours ahead of time just to get their faces made up.
Right. Yes.
But it's funny that after all these other scenes with musicians gathered together and the electrician sitting in the dark doing magic tricks, that this is the least believable thing to me. But they rush to get ready, and what we get next is a 10-minute montage of scenes from Annie.
Yeah, and it's interesting. They're not shown in the correct order. I actually looked up the list. And so I thought that was interesting. They kind of hit all the high notes. They give you definitely, if looking at this, think, I'd love to go see this show. You know, it's a great commercial because it just kind of hits one song, then goes into the next one, then goes into the next one. You see all the different set pieces. So I loved this. I mean, this was the part watching it again today that I was thinking, this is, you know, really like a time capsule. We're seeing this, you know, cast performing this show, which, you know, there usually is no recording for Broadway shows. Usually they will have a recording that is done as archive purposes, but it's never released. So these are, you know, it's really cool to see this.
Yeah. And I imagine for a lot of people watching this for the first time in 1977, that was their only exposure to the show and probably some of these songs.
Right.
They even pump in applause to convince us that this was taped before a live audience on Christmas Eve, despite it airing December 4th.
Right.
But we're treated to cuts of It's a Hard Knock Life.
Yeah. That's probably my, well, there's so many good songs in the show, but that's such a great song.
That's a good one.
It's great. I just love it. I mean, I love seeing this. I love hearing, you know, like hearing the original cast. Cause when I was growing up, I saw the movie version, which had a different cast, mm-hmm. but I had the record album, still have my record album, which was the Broadway cast. And so I remember as a kid being like, some of this stuff isn't the same. You know, there was, you know, some of the songs didn't sound right and stuff. So it was nice to hear the Broadway cast.
Yeah. Like this, the next song that they go to, We'd Like to Thank You, Herbert Hoover. That scene isn't in the movie at all.
Yeah, there's a chicken in every pot.
Yup.
Yeah.
And of course, Tomorrow is next, even though that's before the Herbert Hoover song on the show. But
right,
we get the whole song for Tomorrow. You have to put that whole song in there. If you'd have told me before I started this podcast that I'd be hearing this song Tomorrow in a Christmas special, I wouldn't have believed you. But now it's happened twice.
Ooh.
The last time it came up on this show was on a special Sesame Street Christmas sung by Ethel Merman.
Yeah, that's correct. Yes. So that is a great one. So that's that weird. This is the same year as the famous Sesame Street Christmas special.
Right.
This was like a competing one, which had just Barkley, Big Bird, Oscar. And I think that is all the Muppets. Yeah
that's all the Muppets.
And it's an interesting special. It's not great, but I rewatched it this year. It's one of those, like this special, this Annie special, that I had heard about years before I ever got to see it. And that one eventually was released on DVD, and that's how I first saw it. And it was disappointing the first time because, you know, it's not great and it's not what you're expecting. But then subsequent viewings, you're like, all right, now I'm expecting this. Hey, it's fun. You know, it's weird. It's interesting. So that's right. So now that's good. We got to see if there's ever a third.
Yeah. Oh, I would love to complete that hat trick. But yeah, that's one that grows in you. And it didn't occur to me at that time that it was a relatively new song at the time.
Yeah.
After that, we get Miss Hannigan and her brother Rooster singing Easy Street.
Yeah. And again, they're sort of implying that they're brother and sister, even though they're not. They're actors playing brother and sister. Like, it's everybody sort of is playing themselves, but sort of not. It's like it's very the gray area. It's like watching professional wrestling where you're like, what's going on here? Yeah. I thought that was interesting.
Yeah. A Rooster is played by Robert Fitch. I've talked about him on this podcast before, but there's no way I would have ever recognized him without looking him up, because Robert Fitch was in The Halloween That Almost Wasn't as the mummy.
Wow. Okay. Interesting.
So he's wrapped from head to toe in that. He has no lines. He's just a mummy who's there.
Yeah.
And this is him singing Easy Street with Miss Hannigan.
Yeah. Classic song.
Followed by the Orphan singing You're Never Fully Dressed Without a Smile. That might be my favorite song from this.
It's a beautiful song.
Of how over the top everybody's supposed to be doing anyway, because they're doing a radio song. And they give these girls the whole song on the air too, including their tap dance sequence in the middle, which gets big applause.
Yeah. Now, I will say, normally this kind of stuff, I would say, oh, well, this is what I thought, by the way, during that Sesame Street special, is the put in Christmas songs. If it's not a Christmas song, I don't want it in my Christmas special.
Yeah.
But for this particular show, it makes so much sense for them to sing, you know, these songs. So it's like I give it a full pass on, you know, on doing a whole bunch of non-Christmas songs.
Yeah. And they can't do that New Deal for Christmas song because they can't use FDR because the other guy's playing the theater owner.
Yeah, that's so wild.
Yeah. And finally, Annie and Daddy Warbucks duet, I Don't Need Anything But You.
Together at last, together forever.
Before we end with the entire cast singing Tomorrow in the curtain call.
Mm-hmm.
Well, again, not the entire cast. They were smart enough to keep FDR out of the shot because that guy's playing the theater owner.
Yeah, it's wild.
But the curtain closes and one of the union guys says, okay, everybody off the stage, lights out, electricity costs money. Make sure to be extra Scroogey about it on Christmas Eve. And they kill all of the lights.
Right.
So we're looking at a black screen. All we hear is everyone chaotically shouting, oh, come on, it's Christmas Eve and whatever, before a voice booms above all of them shouting, Merry Christmas! And a spotlight shines on Santa Claus. Santa Claus, what's that? Who's he?
Very good.
Thank you. But he quickly pulls off his hat and beard to reveal it's not Santa, but Mr. Nicolander, the theater owner. He's back from the Bahamas. Or is he? It turns out he was never really going to the Bahamas, and there's no way he wouldn't have a Christmas party for his Annie cast. It's a surprise party.
Yeah, this is all kinds of weird. I mean, it's a weird choice on his part. It is a throwback to him saying he wasn't Santa Claus at the beginning.
Yeah.
So I like that. But yeah, it's a very interesting scene.
Yeah, weird that he was stringing them along this whole time, told all the unions to tell them no, so break all their hearts right before Christmas Eve.
Yeah, this is it's not a really good plan it could have fell apart in so many ways.
Oh yeah, but of course the kids are now all overjoyed, still in the Santa suit, gives them a whole stack of wrapped presents, so they have their party right there on the stage. Mm-hmm. Still set up like Warbucks Mansion with the grand staircase.
Yep, and that giant tree, which we get to see in a little bit.
Oh yeah. Oh, that's a huge tree. And the actor playing Drake the Butler, Edwin Bordo, introduces a special guest, the choreographer of Annie, Peter Gennaro.
Here we are as in olden days, happy golden days of yore. Faithful friends who are dear to us, gather near to us once more.
Now, here's the thing. So I didn't know who this was,
okay,
but I looked him up. He appeared with his own dance troupe on the Ed Sullivan Show.
Yep.
And on, I think it was called the Hit Parade. But he was like a fixture on television as a famous dancer. So audiences at that time, I think, would have known who he was.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, he was a very successful dancer and choreographer. So if you look at his list of choreographer, you know, he did choreography for so many Broadway shows, but he did appear on television and was appearing under his own name. So it sounds like people would have, you know, heard of him.
Okay, yeah, I was looking at his Broadway credits. So he started as an actor in 1948 in Make Mine Manhattan. He was also in Kiss Me Kate and Guys and Dolls before he started in choreography on West Side Story in 1957. And after this, he worked on the stage adaptation of Singing in the Rain. Looks like his last credit is the revival of Annie in 1997.
Yeah, I saw that was listed there. That's pretty crazy.
So this dance number by Peter Gennaro is followed by Andrea McCardle singing a solo of The Little Drummer Boy.
Come, they told me,
walks down to the center of the staircase, so she's positioned perfectly in the middle of a circular window hanging from the set behind her, and it makes it look like she has a little angel's halo.
Ah, yes.
Reminded me of the little kid from the Dick Van Dyke Show episode singing The Little Drummer Boy, which when I was a kid felt like the longest song.
Now, what's your feeling? Because I have found that this song seems to be either people love it like I do. It may be my favorite Christmas song, or I hear it a lot as people's least favorite Christmas song.
I don't dislike it at all. It's a fine song.
Okay, yeah. Like I've seen lists where they'll do a list of people's least favorite Christmas song. That's always towards the top of the ones people don't like to hear.
Oh no, I don't dislike this at all. It's fine.
Yeah, it's great. I think it's so well done here.
Oh yeah. Yeah, it's very well done here. Walks down the stairs. The other girls are kneeling on either side of her, holding imaginary drumsticks in their hands and playing along. It's a nice little setup here.
It's also, by the way, one of my favorite Rankin Bass specials. It might even be my favorite. It's certainly not the one I've seen the most, but I love the Rankin Bass Little Drummer Boy, which I think is criminally underrated. I think the thing about, you know, he won't smile, so they have to put a smile on his face. And then when he goes,
that's such a creepy smile.
It's such a great special with at the end where he's like, there is a king of kings. Go up and play. You do not need to know. Go up and play. I love it. I think it's great. The ghost host from the Haunted Mansion.
Right, I was going to say, that was pretty good Paul Frees.
I love that special. And yeah. I thought of that when I was watching this today. This definitely got me in the mood for Christmas.
Oh, good. Yeah. Well, and afterward, Mr. Nicolander, still in his Santa Claus suit, he's feeling extra festive tonight, announces there are Christmas gifts for everyone. And he announces additional gifts from all the unions that pretended to shut down their party. But it's stuff like from the wardrobe department, free alterations for a year.
On what? Like, it, is on, that on their costume? Because if it is, it shouldn't just be for a year.
Right.
And like all of these things are like, what is this? Why would you say this? Like across the board, it just seems like a mean thing to say to people. Yet every one of them claps as if they're so excited about it.
Right. Yeah. No, it makes sense if it was a joke, considering the next announcement is the stagehand's Christmas gift is their promise to move the set pieces quietly for 3 weeks.
Yes.
Oh, great gift. The electrician's department's gift is they turned on the Christmas tree. You know, the tree that's already part of the set. Why wasn't it on during the party?
Right.
All of these gifts are silly, but wait, here comes Dorothy Loudon. She brings out all the girls' mothers to surprise them at the party.
Yes.
Just the moms. The dads weren't invited. Go home, dads.
This at least I was like, all right, so they're acknowledging that these children are not really orphans, because Marty was like, I think that's what they're implying. Oh,
dear. No, they got their moms to be there for Christmas, which is nice.
Bunch of stage moms show up. You know, there's trouble. You know, some drama's coming.
Yeah. And finally, Mr. Nicolander announces from the music department one Christmas song of their choice. Oh, okay. And this is how we wrap the special up, with the cast of Annie performing the 12 Days of Christmas.
On the first day of Christmas, my true love gave to me a partridge in a pear tree.
Yeah, this is the 12 Days of Christmas is obviously a classic. It's the laziest song. It's got a lot of birds in it. You know, the thing about whether it's, I thought about this while I was watching it. I've heard that there is no such thing as a calling bird.
Yeah.
And that the song originally said collie bird, which means blackbird. And that somehow got lost over time, which sounds totally true. My favorite version of this song, though, is the one from the John Denver and the Muppets album.
Oh, yeah. Other than that, hands down.
Yeah. Other than that version, I'm not a fan.
Yeah, it's fine. I like different versions of it. There's one by Andy Williams that gets like changes all the lyrics, and it's really weird.
Alan Sherman does a very funny version of it with a transistor radio, with one thing you plug into one ear and the other thing you don't plug anywhere because it's broken.
I remember that. Yeah, Andrea and Reed start off with a partridge in a pear tree. The rest of the cast chimes in through the rest of the song. Five golden rings goes to Dorothy, of course.
Five golden rings.
Almost as enthusiastically as Miss Piggy, which was 2 years after this. She does her own bit here. By nine, she remarks, it's getting awfully high, and that's her joke through the rest of it. Peter Gennaro gets to sing Eight Maids of Milking, and then I want to talk about something you may or may not have heard before, if you've heard enough versions of the 12 Days of Christmas. The last four gifts are in a different order than I'm used to hearing.
Oh, I didn't notice this.
So most of the time I've heard this song, it goes 9 ladies dancing, 10 lords a-leaping, 11 pipers piping, 12 drummers drumming. That's the order you're familiar with?
I think so, yeah. Sounds right.
In this, the Annie cast goes 9 drummers drumming, 10 pipers piping, 11 ladies dancing, 12 lords a-leaping.
12 lords a-leaping, ladies dancing, 10 pipers piping, 9 drummers dancing.
Oh, wow.
And I've heard other versions of this that have it in different orders. Just the last four get inconsistent somehow for whatever reason.
That's interesting. I've never noticed that. And I've never, like, you know, you just said it to me now. If you said it in a different order, I think I'd be like, yeah, that's the order. I don't know that I could do the order after five.
Oh, wow. Okay. Yeah. I always notice it when they mix up those last four. For some reason, they always get out of order. But I'll tell you what. The order that they sing it in this special is the order that they used to be in.
Oh, wow. Interesting.
So the 12 Days of Christmas was first published around 1780, I found. And this was the order it was in, the order that they sing it in. The arrangement we know today came around over 100 years later. That was published in 1909.
Wow. Okay. So must be some, you're talking about some music people involved with this. Must have been somebody that was like, hey, let's bring it really super old school.
Yeah. But only parts of it. Like, the original also just started with the first day of Christmas instead of on the first day of Christmas. Gold rings instead of golden rings. And you mentioned collie birds. So it's just, it's evolved over the last 300 years.
But right. Interesting.
Kind of with the invention of recording that you would have versions that you could listen to at home, they started to get more standard. And by the 1960s, you had more of a rhythm that everybody kind of just took from there.
That makes sense.
Yeah, but this one is kind of a combination of the original order of the songs with a more modern arrangement, which I thought was interesting. But then they sing the 12th day twice and a little faster just to bring us home. And that's almost it.
Right. They tell us we've got more.
They say there's a bit more to come. And after one last commercial break, all we see is the cast gathered around singing Jingle Bells.
But we can't hear them, at least on the YouTube version. No. We're hearing a promo for Rich Man, Poor Man. There's a bit more. And I was like, really? And I was like, I don't remember anything more. And then it comes back, like, Rich Man, Poor Man coming up. And the guy just talks the entire time. You miss all of it.
Oh, it's the longest promo.
The bold new daytime drama about people you'll care about. Real people and their real conflicts as they live and love in a contemporary world.
They used to do that. Well, they still do this now. They just, like, instead of doing it over the full picture of the screen, now they just put the credits in a corner and they tell you what's coming up next. But
this, I mean, this would be, if you were going to do a parody of how closing credits would be back then, this would have been what you would have done as a joke, because it covers up the song that they promoted was that we're getting more coming up. And then we got titles on top of them. And then we got a guy shouting over top of their singing.
Yeah. I was also fascinated by the scrolling credits. First, as they scroll into frame, they're red. And then halfway up the screen, they switch the green. Very festive, but very hard to read the red part at the beginning, I thought.
When it moved, it was very hard to read too. Like and it moves fast. And so I was pausing. And there were a lot of frames that I would pause and be like, well, I can't even read it.
Sure. Yeah. And this may very well be like a copy of a copy of a copy of this special. So
sure.
Just a, hey, look what we can do right at the end by the graphics department. But that's it. And what a weird, wonderful little special.
Yeah, I really like it. This is one that I have watched several times over the years because it's one that you can put on and you don't have to pay attention to it. It's like sometimes you're wrapping gifts or something and you can't watch the movie, but you can, or you're decorating the tree and you put this on, you get a lot of music, you get a lot of famous Christmas songs. I think this is a good one.
Yeah. But after watching this, while I was searching for information, I learned there was something of a remake of this special in 2019.
I am totally unaware of this.
So this came about after Martin Sharnan, the original Broadway show's director and lyricist, he died in July 2019. So in his memory, a group of the original cast members got together and put on a one-night-only charity concert staging of it, featuring Andrea McArdle, Danielle Brisbois, Sandy Faison, and Robert Fitch all showed up from this cast. Doesn't look like it was recorded at all, which is a shame. I would have liked to watch it, but...
Sure. Wow, that is very cool. This actually, I feel like, could be, obviously, it could be staged, done on a stage. And I feel like this is something that, I don't know, I would think that audience would really enjoy this. Like, if you had a local theater production of this Annie Christmas special, I think most people in the audience would have never heard of it. So they'd think of it almost as a new thing. It's, you know, it's well thought out, well put together. It works well because it hits the target audience. You got to remember with Annie, you're aiming at adults, but you're also very much aiming at children with this special and this musical.
Yeah. Any other final thoughts on the Annie Christmas show?
No, I mean, this is one you and I have been talking about this for a while. Mm-hmm. And I'm glad we got to see this. Generally, you and I tend to watch together these ones that are almost like variety shows. They're very dated. They're you know, usually not narrative. Like, this has a story, but mostly this is just a showcase of music. And I loved it.
Yeah, I thought it was so great. I want to see more stage shows do this.
Yeah. It was a real clever idea.
Yeah, like imagine the cast of Hamilton trying to throw a Christmas party.
Yeah, I mean, it feels like something they could do. Like, you know, they do it on Disney Plus or whatever, and people say, hi, I should go see that again. Or, you know, I mean, it just,
yeah,
it's great.
You could do this with any show, too. You could put that middle part, which was just a montage of songs from it. You could replace that with anything, and you could do this with any cast, and it would work.
Yeah.
But Guy, thank you again for telling me about this and joining me today. This was a blast.
Oh, it really was. Thank you.
And if people want to demonstrate the joys of conserving electricity by sticking light bulbs in your ears, where can they find you on the internet?
I am at Pointless Nostalgia on YouTube. I post a couple videos every week and talk about stuff like this. So please come check it out.
Yes, please do. And as Guy says, be like the Fonz and gives his videos a thumbs up.
That's it.
World needs more Fonzies. You can find that link in the show notes, and you can find those show notes and wherever I'm hiding, trying to beg people to throw Christmas parties at my website, adventcalendar.house. Tune in next episode when it'll be Halloween in July, where anything can happen. Until then, for Guy Hutchinson, from my backstage break room that's clearly a different room from all the other ones in the building and not just the same stage with different furniture, this is Mike Westfall saying, watch out for the icy patch, but you shouldn't have to do that much longer. The sun will come out tomorrow. Good night, y'all. Next time on the Advent Calendar House.
Anything can happen on Halloween. Your dog could turn into a cat. There may be a toad in your bass guitar, or your sister could turn into a bat.